That we're going to stop fooling around in Iraq. We're going to start to get serious in Afghanistan. I'm going to send the troops over to Afghanistan so that we can win. But win has not been defined, and as a result, there's now some retrenchment. We're not going to send all the troops we need to in order to control Afghanistan, to take care of the border with Pakistan. We're now going to get small. We're playing small ball now. We're going to start to do things locally. That's going to still require more troops, I think, than the president's willing to commit.
Claire Lockhart joins the conversation, Institute for State Effectiveness, co-author of Fixing Failed States. Claire, walk us through, if you would, your point of view and your reporting and those that you have talk to, if you will, that speak to using a standing army in a foreign country to fight a recurring guerrilla force, a la Vietnam or now Afghanistan.
I think it's very important to realize that it's the Afghan National Army and the Afghan forces that are to bear the brunt of stabilizing the country and countering the insurgency. So it's explicit, and General McChrystal's report recognizes that the primary purpose of the mission is to protect the population as a bridging mechanism until those Afghan forces are ready to stabilize the country. And more broadly, the basis ultimately for an exit strategy is going to be when Afghanistan can govern itself as a sovereign country. Every country in the world must be sovereign. It must be able to meet its international obligations and govern its territory. And that's what Afghanistan must do to ensure stability.
So to that end, Claire, what is the threshold and how do you set a threshold for nation building when the expenditure and duration and lives at risk and or lost is unquantifiable?
I think we're absolutely not talking about nation building. The conditions for success, for stability in Afghanistan, are going to be when Afghans can govern their own country. So it's about setting those conditions.
Yeah, that's fine. But when you're talking about U.S. taxpayer dollars and, more importantly, U.S. children's lives, the concept of the Afghans needing to step up and take responsibility is wonderful rhetoric. But the reality is that's not the debate that's going on in the U.S. Congress right now, Jack.
I think the assumption that Afghanistan is either a country now or will ever be a country in a reasonable amount of time that we can stomach is erroneous. Afghanistan is not really a country the way Iraq is even a country. And we've already been there for 8 years. I think it really does come down to a question of whether or not the Congress who writes the bill or the American public
writes the check
on our behalf or the people who elect these people to Congress after 8 years is willing to double down. My guess is in an election year, they're not.
But my argument would be that if it was clear to those who are writing the check and risking their lives that what they were doing was directly responsible for protecting America from the deployment of nuclear, chemical, or biological weapons in our country or against our interests, that you would have much more political will to do it, and that threshold seems to have been lost.
I think it has been. It happens to be a perfectly reasonable argument, and I do believe it happens to be true in this case. Southwest Asia is very dangerous, but after 8 years of flopping around and being diverted by Iraq, I do not think that the American public would believe it, even if you put it right in their faces.
All right, Claire, thank you very much, and that goes to the corruption in our government, which diminishes our credibility. It's sort of like crying wolf, whether it's the banks or the health care or the rest of it. We lose our credibility with the most important issue, which is the lives of our children. It's very disturbing.
Very disturbing indeed.